Good evening. Hello, everybody. Hi. My name is Judy Miller. I'm the Dean of Arts and Humanities. And I'm delighted to be at the Institute again this evening, where I learn always as much from my colleagues as I do from my students. So tonight, we're here for a very special evening, a very special conversation on the Cairo Genizah. And I'm here to introduce the speakers, which I intend to do right now. The person who will be leading the discussion is someone that you all know very well if you've been coming to our Institute lectures, and that's Professor Philip Kennedy, who directs this Institute, who teaches literature and Emirati culture with us, and who is the editor-in-chief of the Monumental Project, which is a translation of main Arabic texts into English, called the Library of Arabic Literature. He will be interviewing Professor Mark Cohen and our writer in residence, Amitav Ghosh. Professor Cohen has just retired from Princeton, where he was the Kaduri A. Zilka Professor of Jewish Civilization in the Near East and Professor of Near Eastern Studies. He retired in order to work harder, which is what a lot of people do when they retire. And I'm grateful for that because I'm looking forward to it myself. He has picked up the pace of his scholarly activities, if anything. He is now lecturing throughout the Arab world about Muslim and Jewish relations. And he has been with us this semester and is coming back, teaching a course on Muslims and Jews in the Arab world in the Middle Ages. In addition to that, he's been teaching a course on the relatively ancient language of Judeo-Arabic, and he has 11 students who are taking it not for credit and seemingly doing quite well. Among his many publications, I will cite only his recently re-edited book, Under Crescent and Cross, The Jews in the Middle Ages, which has been translated into 9 different languages, including Arabic. Amitav Ghosh, who holds a PhD in anthropology from Oxford, is a major writer of prose fiction. His some dozen novels and studies take us from the Indian Ocean to the opium wars between England and China, from a dystopic malaria-ridden future to the agrarian Egypt of the 1970s. I will mention here only the titles of his recent Ibis trilogy, which I hope you've all read, Sea of Poppies, River of Smoke, and the third volume, which is going to come out in May and which is greatly anticipated, Flood of Fire. Is that still the title?
Yes.
Sometimes these things change. I found it in Wikipedia. We're very lucky to have Amitav here. It's the second time he's come to visit us. He's following our own student writers. He's speaking in numerous venues. In fact, he's going to Sharjah next week for the book fair. And he's completing several articles and studies on, among other things, the Indian presence in World Wars I and II. His 1992 hybrid text, In an Antique Land, is what brought him to Mark Cohen, as they shared and share a great interest in the Cairo Genizah, which figures as a real and symbolic space in an antique land. And the Genizah, a repository for manuscripts in Cairo, is what will be discussed tonight. How the rediscovered but battered treasure house tells stories of Jewish-Muslim coexistence since the Middle Ages. So let us begin and plunge into a world of cross connections that suggest mutual influence and fellowship. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy, for a very full introduction. And you've really pointed us in the right direction. So you said I was going to lead a discussion. I mean to point us in the right direction. I mean to speak less than anybody else on this panel, because we have a great scholar in Mark Cohen here, and a great writer. also a scholar in Amitav Ghosh. And I am just one of their readers. I must say, one of the transformative experiences in reading has been in my life the reading of the first two volumes of the Sea of the Ibis trilogy. I'm sorry, around the Sea of Poppies and the River of Smoke. So I can't wait until this coming spring. So get on with it, Philip. Now I'd like to begin actually by reading the blurb, which you've all read, and it really covers some of what Judy has already said, but it really does set us on the right track. And actually there's some things about the blurb that I'd like to pick up, because it's the title of this evening is The Cairo Genizah and the Making of In an Antique Land. At the end of the 19th century, travellers discovered a treasure trove of old manuscripts in the Genizah of a medieval synagogue in old Cairo. They had been deposited there during a millennium because, written in the Hebrew alphabet and usually mentioning the name of God, they could not be thrown out with the trash. A similar custom exists in Islam for Quran fragments. The papers include hundreds of letters written by Jewish merchants living in the Mediterranean Islamic lands in the Middle Ages who travelled as far as India. So my first question really is to Mark Cohen, Professor Cohen. The title we have is the Cairo Genizah, but we often refer to it as just the Genizah. And so the question is the Cairo Genizah the Genizah, or is it a Genizah?
It's both. this is a custom, a Jewish custom that goes back several hundred years before the rise of Islam to, as you say, to dispose of holy writings in a way that treats them with piety. And Jews to this day practice the same custom, at least traditional Jews. So this is Genizah, one of many. What's special about the Cairo Genizah is that it was in Cairo. And anybody who's traveled to Egypt knows that it doesn't rain very much in Cairo. And because of the aridity of the climate, aridness of the climate, these papers did not mold. And indeed, the writing on them, even if they're torn and tattered and have to be reconstructed, is as legible today as written as much as 1,000 years ago. And the second unique factor of the Cairo Genizah is that, unlike the typical case where the Genizah is buried in the ground, in the cemetery, along with human beings, this Genizah was buried inside a synagogue behind a wall, so that once it was discovered, it was very easy to access it, remove the papers, and begin studying them.
Mm-hmm. So one thing I meant to mention is that to me, in thinking about the question, is that to me, Genizah, if I think, you know, Hebrew is a Semitic language, therefore there are lots of cognates with Arabic, but to me, that the sound of the Genizah evokes Genezah, of course, which is a burial. The Genezah is the sort of ritual burial of a human being, and also the word, the root kens, the sense of a treasure.
Well, that's the origin of the word. The word is not found in the Bible. It's found in post-biblical writings. It comes from Persian kans, which mm-hmm. means treasury in Persian, which also came into Arabic as janazah or ganazah, if you live in Egypt or other places where that consonant mm-hmm. is pronounced as a g. And you have, of course, in Islam, you have salat al-janazah, which mm-hmm. is the prayer, the funerary prayer. And there you can see a connection between funerary, burial, and burial of sacred papers. Mm-hmm. And the Genizah phenomenon is indeed, as you said, perfectly ordinary in Islam. I always ask my Muslim students, what happens at home if you find a page of the Quran on the floor that you can't fit back into an original binding? And they say, we burn it. So burning is the most typical form of Genizah for Muslims. There are other options as well. Mm-hmm.
But there's something unique about the Cairo Genizah, the Genizah of the Ben Ezra Mosque, synagogue, excuse me. Is there a reason particular to the Ben Ezra Mosque that this Genizah is an accumulation of so many centuries?
Yes, well, that also was a great surprise to scholars. First of all, I should give you some figures. There are, in total, about 330,000 pieces of paper in the Cairo Genizah, spread amongst approximately 70 libraries and private collections throughout the world, from Cincinnati, Ohio in the west, to St. Petersburg in the east, and practically every place in between where you have major libraries, the largest collection being in Cambridge, England, Cambridge University Library. And what makes this Genizah particularly valuable and not quite unique, because Islamic Genizahs sometimes also represent this kind of a distribution, but apart from the expected religious literature, which perhaps forms something like 95% of the material, another 3 to 5%, amounting to something like 15 to 18, 19,000 documents, come from everyday life, and we might call them secular, business letter from one merchant to another, but whenever one wrote a letter, one said, may God bring us great profit. So, I mean, P-R-O-F-I-T. So these letters, were not scrupulously examined to make sure they didn't contain the name of God. It was assumed that a Jew writing a letter would praise God quite consistently throughout that. And therefore, that's the particular type of document that I work on and that formed the basis of Amitav's book.
Yeah. It's just, I wonder about the... I can't help wondering, actually, and the more I read about it, the more it strikes me that this Genizah is a very unique Genizah in an extent of what it's given us historically.
It certainly is.
And what I'm just trying to, I wonder if I could just push in. You, by the way, Amitav, do interrupt us or intervene whenever you.
Sure.
I don't want to sort of.
Let me give you some examples of where it's unique. Apart from the fact that it contains documents from everyday life. By the way, that is a very, very precious source because we do not have such documents for Muslims. Mm-hmm. By and large, very, very few documents from everyday life for those centuries, and the centuries for which the Genizah is richest are the 11th, 12th, and early part of the 13th mm-hmm. centuries. So we learn about Jewish merchants, but the Jewish merchants follow the very same practice that Muslims did, and so it's an important source for Islamic economic life, mm-hmm. for instance. It also has, and I'll show you some, first of all, this is the synagogue. Before it was renovated, beginning in 1983, between 1983 and 1993 it was renovated. A project following the peace treaty between Egypt and Israel, the World Jewish Congress decided that it would fund a project that would symbolize the friendship between Israel or Jews and Egypt, and so they decided to renovate the synagogue so that it looks like this today. Moving on, this is the interior of the synagogue, and anybody who knows something about architecture will readily recognize that this looks like a Coptic basilica with the columns there. And the synagogue is nested amongst many, many Coptic churches. This is in old Cairo, or called Fustat, which was heavily Christian in the Middle Ages. And so the synagogue itself has that. The Genizah itself is found on the second floor behind a wall, today accessible through a window. And this view here is not a picture from the 12th century, believe me, but rather it is a diorama of what it looked like in the Middle Ages, mm-hmm. people depositing documents, papers in the Genizah. Then this diorama is found at the Museum of the Diaspora, Jewish Diaspora, at Tel Aviv University in Israel. This is a picture of the scholar who was identified most famously with the discovery of the Genizah and bringing papers back to Europe, a man by the name of Solomon Schechter at Cambridge University Library, who was a reader in rabbinics there, and he learned about the Genizah through a very interesting process. Two Christian Presbyterian sisters who were Hebraists came to him one day. They'd been in the Middle East and collecting manuscripts, and they found some manuscript they could not read, even though they knew Hebrew, brought it to him, and he recognized this immediately, or rather a few hours after examining it, as the pages from the Hebrew original of the lost Hebrew original of the biblical book of Ecclesiasticus, or the Wisdom of Ben Sira, which is preserved in Greek and Slavonic and only in the Christian Bible. And so he found the first evidence of the actual Hebrew original. There were quotations from the Wisdom of Ben Sira in the Talmud and rabbinic literature, but now he was able to prove that indeed the original was in Hebrew. And this excited him so much that he raised some money and went off to Cairo with letters from the chief rabbi of England and met up with the chief rabbi of Egypt and had access to this. This is not a picture of the Genizah itself, but rather the basement of Cambridge University Library. And here the crates are open, and here he's sitting in the background pondering over these documents. And it's quite clear that he purposely posed himself there to show that he had been he was the master of the Genizah.
Yeah. It's quite a mess, actually, you think.
It is.
Yeah.
This, by the way, I want to just show. This is perhaps will be remarkable for some people. I'm going to read to you from this text. First of all, notice it's in Hebrew letters, but the language is Arabic. Because the Jews Arabized very early after the Islamic conquest, and they wrote nearly everything they did write in Arabic, but in Hebrew characters, called, as Judy mentioned, Judeo-Arabic. Now, I'm going to read this to you, and you'll be a little surprised. The first line after the heading, it says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Does anybody know what that is? That's the Fatiha, the first surah of the Quran. So Jews were interested in Islam and Islamic texts. And this one is particularly interesting because there actually was a rule that said that non-Muslims should not teach the Quran to their children. Mm-hmm. But here you see, of course, they were doing it, or they were copying because they were interested. And this is not the only fragment of the Quran in Judeo-Arabic. Mm-hmm.
So that brings us to the point of, I think, one of the main bents of your scholarship, or one of the main interests of your scholarship, that is the relationship between the Jewish materials and the Islamic society. But before we go to that content, could I just, and this is harking back to my first question, which is, why did this, I'm thinking pragmatically, physically, why this particular Genizah accumulated so much? And it seems to me that, as you said, most other Genizahs were buried in the ground, but this was for some reason, that maybe there's no explanation of origins, but it was made inaccessible. So because it was made inaccessible,
right,
no one thought, okay, I'm going to spend my Sunday afternoon burying the Genizah, or getting...
Well, there...
So it just accumulated.
When it was first discovered, scholars were very surprised that it was buried inside a building rather than in the cemetery. Mm. And in fact, in 1911 and 12, some Jewish scholars did dig in the cemetery and did indeed find medieval fragments. Mm. So the question is why? The greatest scholar of all who study this material, Shlomo Dov Goitein, theorized, and this is a rather ingenious theory, that the first of all, the synagogue, along with many, many churches, was destroyed at the beginning of the 11th century as a result of a wave of persecution under the Caliph al-Hakim, who was a rather strange bird, and it's not quite clear why he suddenly lashed out at the non-Muslims, and then he turned around and said they could all reconvert to Judaism without impunity, which was also very strange, since conversion from Islam to any other religion is considered to be a cardinal sin. But the point Goitein made was perhaps we also know from a Genizah document that in December of 1011, there was a procession to bring a Jewish learned man to the burial in the cemetery. And during this time of chaos, this Jewish funerary procession was attacked, and 23 Jews were arrested and sentenced to death. And the Jews appealed to the caliph, the very same caliph who was persecuting Christians and Jews, and he pardoned them. As a result, they wrote a scroll commemorating this pardon and celebrated this annually. So Goitein thought, well, maybe when they were rebuilding the synagogue, which they did, and we know about that because we have lists of the building materials in the Genizah, they decided to build the Genizah inside the synagogue so they didn't have to at least carry papers to the cemetery, mm-hmm. and they could cut down on the number of funerary possessions. Mm-hmm. But in subsequent research that I did with another scholar, we discovered that Jews from Muslim lands frequently deposited their Genizah inside their synagogues or underneath in the basement of their synagogues. So it turns out not to be, you need Goitein's explanation. Mm-hmm. And this chamber was huge in the sense, I measured it once in 1983, I was there and I eyeballed it. It's something like 5 meters deep by 2.5 by 2.5 meters. And so it could hold, because it was 2 stories high. It went from the floor to the ceiling of the second mm-hmm. story, the mezzanine.
Yeah, I mean, it struck me, it seemed that Schechter was risking his neck when he went into that niche. Well, he's sitting on 5 meters. You
know, he claimed in a letter to his wife, who was back in New York, in Cambridge, that he had gotten filthy. He wrote about, he wrote to her in a mixture of English, German, and Yiddish, and he said, he called it Genizah Schmutz, which means Genizah dirt. And he gave the impression that he actually entered the mm-hmm. window and brought things out. If you saw a picture of his girth, I don't believe that he could have possibly gone. I think he was exaggerating, and I think people brought things out from and mm-hmm. spilled them on the floor. Mm-hmm. And he, by the way, he didn't take any printed material, only manuscripts. Mm-hmm. And he crated them up, mm-hmm. and they were shipped from Egypt yeah. to Cambridge.
So some of the things you mentioned, we want to come to Goitein and the significance of the work of Goitein. And of course the other people that, I mean, he comes at the end of a chain of scholars and collectors. So I'd want to come back to that with Amitav as well. Can we go back to the theme of Islam? And
yes.
Would you say something then about what significance you think the Genizah holds to Islam, Muslims or Islamic studies or Islamic history?
What it shows us, and this is not clear if we read only the Islamic theoretical literature about the status of non-Muslims, which means Jews, Christians, and Zoroastrians primarily. But in India, of course, the Hindus were included into the same category. One would get the impression that non-Muslims were continuously under threat, oppression, and periodic persecution. And clearly they were second-class subjects. They were inferior. They were required to pay a special tax annually, which is stipulated in the Quran. And there were other restrictions upon them, such as sartorial regulations, certain clothing they had to wear. But what the Genizah reveals, at least for these centuries, is that these rules, with the singular exception of the tax, which was, after all, a fiscal matter, the Jews were not restricted in any significant way. They had complete freedom of religion, freedom of self-government, freedom of economic movement. They rarely experienced oppression. This persecution under al-Hakim was the exception that proves the rule. And that they had freedom of movement across the Mediterranean, or from Spain on one end all the way to India, and they did traverse these lengths. There are indications, strong indications, that Jews with great, great frequency took law cases, cases of legal problems, to the Muslim court, had faith in the just treatment that they would receive there. Jewish religious leaders complained about this, which is another indication that Jews were doing it all the time. By the way, the Christians did the very same thing, and the bishops complained about that. So, lastly, the cultural documents of the Geniza, which show Jews embedded in Arabic Islamic culture to the extent that you know very well from your work in Arabic poetry, from law to scriptural commentary to philosophy to mathematics to science, all of the things that the Muslims were studying, and the Jews followed suit. And the one area where the Jews chose to write not in Arabic but in Hebrew was poetry. But that again shows an acculturative dimension, because Jews had never written Arabic poetry before in biblical Hebrew, except for the Psalms, where the structure is much different, let alone adopting Arabic metrics, which was entirely new.
That was
and
done
the
in
thematics of Hebrew poetry are very much the same as those of secular Arabic poetry.
That happened in Spain.
But well before Spain, it happened in the East. Yeah. It started in the East, in the center of the Abbasid Caliphate in Iraq, and it trickled its way across the Mediterranean and flourished in Spain. Mm-hmm. And so we know mostly about it, or think about it as being an Andalusian phenomenon, but it is not an Andalusian phenomenon. It's a pan-Islamic Jewish phenomenon.
Okay. Do you want to comment on anything, Amitav?
Well, I would just add that I think the Geniza is also a very remarkable source for Indian history, because there's so much material from the Indian Ocean. And that was certainly what attracted me to it. You know, it was these traces of trans-Indian Ocean voyages. And that was really, you know, what took me to it. And I think it's still a very, very underexplored source for Indian history.
Mm-hmm. I want to have two comments before we come to your work on the Geniza, and the particular story that you traced. What I find odd about, what is true about the Geniza, regarding what we know about it now, say what is written in this book, which I brought because I wanted to recommend it, actually. Adina Hoffman and Peter Cole, Sacred Trash, The Lost and Found World of the Cairo Genizah. It's not actually so much an inventory of what the Geniza contains, perhaps because that would require them to write 10 volumes of. Rather, they've written a book which starts really with Schechter and his encounter of those two Presbyterian women. And it also describes the machinations of Schechter, because he had an axe to grind. Anti-Karaite or whatever, but what strikes me as odd is that, you know, there were 130, however many thousand manuscripts you mentioned that had accumulated or at least survived almost a millennium, and within, you know, within a few years of Schechter's having been invited to examine the materials, the whole collection had dispersed. So the rabbinic leaders or the Jewish leaders of Cairo were quite happy to see this material, this treasure, disbanded to the world. And it's so what is the, it's a puzzle to me. I mean, it's not a puzzle if you think about the fact that normally a Geniza was burnt, that was the ultimate goal, but given that it had accumulated this way, one would have thought there would have been a bit more a desire to preserve what was obviously a material and historical treasure. So Schecht, of course, was responsible for taking the majority of manuscripts to Cambridge with the help of Taylor of St. John's College, and that became the Schechter-Taylor collection. Oxford had already acquired some, and then it ended up in the Jewish Theological Seminary, I think, when Schechter went there. Of course, you mentioned Cincinnati, and then there's there are other collections too, which you've used. Well, so why were they so willing to let this go?
I don't think that the chief rabbi of Cairo, when Schechter arrived, had any idea what was buried there. He couldn't, because the best he could do was skim the surface and see that were documents were most recent from, say, because there are documents as late as the last years of the 19th century, almost the day before Schechter arrived. Mm-hmm. That's one thing. Secondly, it's not impossible that Schechter paid some bakshish for this. Also, there was this letter from the chief rabbi of England, which must have had an impact on him. And Schechter wasn't the first. There were others who came and, one way or another, got a hold of some manuscripts, which they then began to sell to whoever was interested in buying, be it the Bodleian Library in Oxford or Cambridge. I mean, one particular manuscript hunter had offered documents to Cambridge before 1896, and Schechter wasn't interested until these two Scottish sisters brought him these pages. And you're right, he had an axe to grind. He wanted to prove that the Book of Ben Sira had been originally Jewish and not Greek. There was a scholar at Oxford at the same time who was trying to prove that it was Greek. Mm-hmm. And he happened to be a convert from Judaism to Christianity, so there was a kind of a rivalry there, not to speak of the old rivalry between Oxford and Cambridge. So there were multiple reasons for this. Some people ask me, well, you know, it's supposed to be buried, sacred burial, yes. And what about removing it there? The answer is, as long as these papers are not then burnt, destroyed, because in Judaism they can't be burnt. In Islam, yes. And if they are brought to a library and bound in volumes and placed between protective coverings to be studied by scholars, it's equivalent to Geniza. I mean, so there is no problem. No one ever complained that the Geniza was being removed from its burial spot to a spot which would take away from the sacred nature of the act itself. So the question is a good one, but I think we don't know the whole story.
Mm-hmm. There's another aspect to it which is certainly interesting to anyone who's familiar with the colonial context. I mean, you have to remember that Egypt was then a British protectorate. It was under Lord Curzon, who was always very keen to ship out anything he could find. And it's also interesting that, I mean, before Schechter, there was a man called Elkan Adler, who was, you know, from a very upper-class Jewish family in London. And he ends up in Cairo. And it's very interesting, you know, he wrote a piece on visiting the Geniza and his time in Cairo. And it's so interesting. I mean, he speaks of Egyptian Jews in a very straightforwardly colonial language. He calls them aborigines, and sort of describes them as sort of like wild savages who are, it's an extraordinary sort of rhetoric, you know, and it's a rhetoric in which I'm sure the leaders of the Cairo Jewish community were actually complicit, Because within the Cairo Jewish community, there were different communities. There was a sort of later Sephardic community, but then there were also the Oriental Jews, who were the earlier Jewish Jewish community, the community that had actually been responsible for producing and nurturing the Genizah, were in fact the Oriental Jews. But they found themselves at this point being despoiled, as it were, by later sort of influxes of Jewish communities from elsewhere, who regarded them clearly as quite inferior. You know, so there was very much a sort of colonial dynamic happening there between England and Egypt, between the local colonial administration and the local Jewish community, but also within the Jewish community itself, mm-hmm. you know, which was actually several kinds of communities.
Exactly.
Yeah. So I was wondering, we need to talk about Goitein and the work that he did. I mean, he seems to have been the great scholar of the greatest scholar of the Genizah. I mean, the one who's devoted his most time. And so much so that, in fact, he'd worked on it for decades before, and it was published just before he died, But his book, of course, his multi-volume oeuvre is called Mediterranean Society, which gives emphasis to the Mediterranean aspect of what's in the Genizah, historically, economo-political history. But what wasn't obvious when he published that, those volumes, and when he subsequently died, was that he'd been working on the Indian material. He knew that there was this Indian dimension. Do you want?
Well, he had begun that way. I mean, the first part of Goitein's career, after he came from his PhD in Frankfurt in Germany to Palestine in 1923, he got involved first in high school education and then was asked to be the head of the Department of Oriental Studies at the newly formed Hebrew University in 1925. And his interests were in Islamic literature, Arabic literature, Islamic law. And he was in Budapest the end of the 40s, and he was looking for material from the Genizah on law. And he discovered there papers from a lawsuit in the Jewish court of Fustat from the end of the 11th century that took place between a Jew living in Cairo or Old Cairo and another Jew who was a Jewish trader who went all the way to India as his agent. And there was a dispute between the two of them, and it ended up in the Jewish court. And that sort of was a eureka for Goitein. He realized that there must be a lot of material on the India trade, and there was virtually no documentation for the medieval India trade. We knew a lot about the Portuguese period, but not about the 11th, 12th century. Mm-hmm. And he was planning to write a book about that, and then he realized that he has to write a book first about the Mediterranean, and then come to the India trade. He died before he had a chance to finish the India book, and it has since been published in parts by one of his disciples. Amitav came to looking, I think you, when you were thinking of writing this book, you'll tell us more about it. Mm-hmm. I think you were looking to meet with Goitein, weren't you?
Yes, I had no idea that Goitein had died. And, I'd been introduced to this material through an early book of his called Letters of Medieval Jewish Traders. And, you know, I came upon that quite fortuitously, and there was a reference to an Indian slave, which got me interested. Mm-hmm. You know, I sort of wanted to track the career of this Indian slave. So yes, at a certain point, I thought, let me go and speak to Professor Goitein. And then I turned up at Princeton, and of course, somebody directed me to Mark, and I went there, and Mark said, well, you know, Professor Goitein's dead. He's been dead for 5 years now. So you're not going to get much going in that direction.
So you were stuck with me.
So I said to him, look, I know, because I'd been reading up about Professor Goitein, that he'd done sort of preliminary translations of Ben Yehuda's letters. So I said to Mark, well, could I please have access to those letters? And he said, no way, because Professor Goitein restricted access to that material. So I said, but look, I mean, you have to help me here, do something. And he said, no, he said, you can do it. You just have to go and learn Judeo-Arabic. So that was his message to me. And I thought he was joking, actually, you know, I mean, you know, there's this language which like 10 people in the world are familiar with, and I've got to go off and learn Judeo-Arabic. And then he said to me, he said, look, you know, it's actually just spoken colloquial Arabic. And I'd already spent a year living in Egypt. So I was at that point in my life really quite fluent in colloquial Arabic. And he said, it's just colloquial Arabic written in the Hebrew script. So all you have to do is to learn the Hebrew script. And in fact, written Hebrew is much easier to decipher than written Arabic, because it's not, you know, Arabic is cursive, it becomes much, much more difficult actually to decipher it, yeah.
It's the joining of the letters.
That's right, it's the joining of the letters. Yeah. Whereas Hebrew is sort of like separate letters, so so I armed myself with the only textbook there was on Judeo-Arabic. It was by a man called Blau, you'll remember. And I learned the Hebrew script, and I went off to Oxford, and it was actually quite amazing in those days, because in Cambridge, you know, they had a very modern kind of, already then they had a very modern sort of room for the Taylor Schechter collection. But I was the only person there who was without a yarmulke, you know, which was quite striking. they would actually bring you the papers, you know, so you would touch the paper. I mean, this is paper from the 12th century, you know. Mm. And you would touch it, you would see the flow of the ink, you would see where his pen had blotted, you would see, you know, on the verso, the little scribblings that he'd made. And, you know, Mark was saying to me the other day that now all these are available in digital copies, but I just don't think it can be the same thing, you know. I mean, the actual sort of tactile sensation of dealing with those materials, mm-hmm. it's just so different. Because, you know, it has a sort of material presence, which is in its own way really incredibly thrilling, you know. Because you think of this paper, the paper that Ben Yehuda used to write on was Dimashki paper, you know, it was from Damascus. But it wasn't actually from Damascus, it was just like a, you know, like we say, you know, it was just sort of like a brand name. It was probably manufactured in Egypt itself, wasn't it? But then the paper would be sent to him from Egypt to Mangalore, where he was living. Mangalore is just above Kerala, you know. And Kerala is a very, I mean, that climate, and you know, I live on that coast now. And it's a climate which is incredibly hostile to paper. You know, I mean, even just books, we have to take out and put them in the sun at least twice a year. It's just an incredible bother. Mm-hmm. But it went from there to the west coast of India. It's, you know, many of these bits of paper spent 10, 12, 17 years in India. Then they came back with him, you know, all the way to Cairo. Then they were put into this Genizah. There they lasted another, 800 years, you know. Mm-hmm. So if you just think of the journey of this material object, it's, I mean, that in itself has a kind of enchantment mm-hmm. which, you know, one really can't describe. And really, you know, when you hold that paper in your hand, you realize that, you know, what we call, I mean, this paper is really just trash compared to compared to that. Mm-hmm. Because that paper is so beautiful, it's almost like cloth in a way, you know, but you can actually see the fibers crossing and you can imagine what it would be like to write on it. Actually, you know, there's a wonderful paper manufacturer in Cairo now.
Yes.
Yes, right behind Al-Azhar. And in fact, I get all my writing pads from him. You can actually order it. Abdel Fattah, I think, is the name. But it's, I mean, he produces just beautiful paper and beautiful bindings. Mm-hmm. You know, when I write on that paper now, I feel the pleasure of, you know. So, you know, in a sense, I think if I were, had just been dealing with the, you know, with the digital copy, it would never have come alive for me in the way that it did. Because, you know, sitting there in the Taylor Schechter room, I remember the first week or so was incredibly frustrating. I was just not getting anywhere. And then suddenly one day it just came alive, you know, because actually it's true. He was writing in colloquial Arabic. And I recognized expressions that were used in the village that I'd lived in, you know. And that was really when the voice became so incredibly expressive. Because, of course, when you read Arabic in general, you never have that experience of a colloquial language coming alive, simply because it's diglossic and, you know.
Mm-hmm. Can we talk about the contents and the inspiration for your book in an antique land? I mean, I think everybody wants to know some of the inspiration, the thinking that went into it, and the creativity, because it seems to me quite a unique book, or almost unique. But what I was wondering, just first of all, just to get over with some pragmatic questions, I was wondering as I read the book a second time, there's some things I have to say about that actually, how I read it a second time from the first reading. You talked about being in the Taylor Schechter Library. How much traveling did you have to do to put together the story of Ben Yezu? Did you have to go to other libraries?
Yes. But, I think sort of like 90% of his letters were between Oxford and Cambridge. And in fact, it was the way that these documents were given to you at Oxford was even stranger. They would just have like, you know, 50 of them tied up, and they would just come and dump them in front of you. And there you were, you know. But there were a couple of documents also in America. One of them, which I really needed, was in Philadelphia. So I went to look at it there, and it was such a different experience. It was like going into Fort Knox. I mean, you know, there was a huge plastic thing, and you had to put your hands through gloves and go like this. And I mean, you know, it was so different from the experience at Cambridge and Oxford. I'm sure it's all changed now at Cambridge. I'm sure. I mean, I get the impression that there as well, they've sort of put in place a whole set of, you know, preservation rituals.
Had Goitein helped you created a sort of inventory of where the Ben Yezu materials are?
There was an inventory, but I don't know if I got it from Goitein. It's a long time ago now, remember. As far as I remember, I compiled it, but something that Mark gave me some sort of catalog or something that helped.
Right, there was a list.
Goitein, there was a list.
Right.
Yes, I think it was from that list that I compiled the list, yeah.
Right, and he had divided it into subject areas, and he had in mind a whole volume devoted to Ibn Yezu.
Yeah.
So I think you had access to that.
That's right.
With the shelf marks.
Yeah, but again, there, you know, the cataloging system of those Genizah, I mean, I'm sure it's much better now, but in those days it used to be so wild, because the Taylor Schechter collection, even there, their shelf marks were all, I mean, you know, they were just like, seemed almost completely random. And then when you went to, I mean, the Oxford collection was also, it had its own sorts of collections, and there was no sort of overarching thing. Mm-hmm. But of course, the thing is, if you stick with these things for long enough, eventually you can sort of put them all together, I think.
So could we talk about the book itself, the nature of the book and what it's about? Because, as I said, I've read it twice now, quite carefully. The first time because, it's one of the books I confess that I hadn't read for years, which all my friends had read in my field. You know.
I have to say that and whenever I have graduate students, I recommend that they read this book, and they've all read it already.
Yeah. So I came to it rather late. I mean, it's a confession. I mean, but. Then the first book of yours I read was Sea of Poppies, and then and then some other novels, and including the River of Smoke, and then I came to this. So, from what I'd heard, I read it as a book about you and your time in Egypt, and then I was puzzled about the way it started with this, you know, MSH6, the slave, you know, and there was a sort of anonymity about that, which I realise is deliberate in the way you structured the discussion of the slave who emerges as bomber. So there's a kind of recognition there, the anagnorisis we talked about. Let me just make this brief. When I first read the book, I felt I was reading it about a book about you and your experience in Egypt, and then you discovered Benyejou's story as something that could comment on that experience as a human being, and as there was some kind of universalism of the experience that you found in Benyejou's story that reflected on your being in Egypt. And if you just look at the geography of your life up to that point, you know, you'd India, and England, Egypt. I mean, so you got the West, you've got Egypt, and you've got the East. And very crassly put, I suppose, or very basically put. But and of course, the theme of war and exile was there. But when I read it a second time this week, I thought I wouldn't read it, but then I thought I should read it. And I read really with concentrating on Benyejou, and then Benyejou came alive for me. Actually, I realized in the first reading I hadn't really taken on as much as I should have. I mean, a lot of the detail I didn't remember, but it made so much sense, and it sort of evoked a lot of what I know about the history of Schechter, etc. And it's actually a very, it's a great story. It's not interspersed commentaries on your life, which has a sort of teleology, I suppose. But there's a teleology in that story, and of course there's some. I saw more and more the way that the life of Benyejou towards the end, especially, reflected a kind of a zeitgeist that you were feeding after the war in Iraq, you know, and the dispersal of family for economic needs. So I just wonder, I suppose, those are my comments of how I read it. I think it's a beautiful story, and I see it as a family romance, you know, with a separation and return to family. Story of, I suppose, the slave. I wonder there if I've put too much emphasis in what I've just said on Benyejou, given that you start with the story of the slave and you end with the naming of the slave. And even an explanation of what. There's an explanation of the details of which I can't remember, but this bomb obviously has supreme importance in the book, because you start with him and you discover his identity in a sense. So it's about discovery of identity to some extent. So those are my rambling thoughts. But really, I'm just saying that you can read the book with different emphases, and perhaps next time I read it, that'll be the answer, because it'll all come together as a sort of smooth alloy of inspiration. But I want to ask you the question now: where would you put the weight of the book in the given the way that you've constructed it as a story?
I don't know that I would put it in any particular place. You have to remember that, you know, I didn't write that book didn't come out of an academic context, and which is why it must strike you as being, you know, an oddity in a way, because I had written two novels before I started writing this book. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was writing it very much in a context where I was also working as a journalist, where I was covering other stuff. So, for example, I mean, latter parts of the book actually come out of journalistic articles that I was writing. And, you know, this happened to be a time, the late 80s, the 80s and 90s, when there was a lot of really interesting work being done in journalism and in nonfiction. Journalism, of course, there was Hunter Thompson and so on. But in nonfiction, there was Bruce Chatwin. And Bruce Chatwin was really, I would say, a great inspiration to me, because especially if you read his In Patagonia, which follows like a trail of mm-hmm. letters and a trail of manuscripts into Patagonia. And that was in many ways a kind of inspiration mm-hmm. for me. Mm-hmm. And that was what, you know, sort of got me working in this direction. I suppose in the most basic way, I wanted to express something about my own feelings about history, about the world. And the thing I feel what my first book was about, what my second book was about, was exactly the sense of a sort of transnational connectedness. You know, a sort of interrupted and a constantly sort of broken transnational connectedness. Mm-hmm. And it was something I experienced so much even in writing this book, you know, because when I wanted to go to Cambridge to do the research for it, the first hurdle I had was trying to get a visa. You know, when you think of projects like that coming from where I am in the world, it assumes a completely different aspect from what it does for Western students, writers, scholars, because there's a whole sort of institutional barrier that you have to sort of cope with, you know. Mm-hmm. The first time I tried to get a visa, to go to England to, do this work in Cambridge, the guy just flatly said to me, no, you can't go. And, I just felt such anger and despair thinking, it's a part of my history, you know, and how can they just tell me that I can't go? So I protested, I wrote letters, and this and that, and finally I managed to get a visa to go and do this work. But, you know, it's all those, it's because you face those, these peculiar sorts of hurdles, which are not in any sense scholarly hurdles, you know, or hurdles to do with anything to do with writing. Those aspects of history become very alive to you. You know, what are the interruptions in those histories? What are the interruptions in these connections? And I suppose, you know, it's a curious thing. At the most basic level, what I was trying to express was, an idea that Sanjay Subramaniam, the Indian historian, has summed up in this beautiful phrase of connected histories. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's really what In an Antique Land is. It's a connected history.
And it's from one perspective as well, because it struck me when I was reading about the raid on Aden by the pirates from Kish.
Yeah.
Qais, actually, that was, that's part of, if you look at UAE history, then the UAE is a very young country. And I teach a course on the UAE, and I say to the students that there's a tendency to see this as a young country, and that's all. Because you don't, it's very little to go beyond the 41 years or 40 years, however many years it is, and also the very marked boundaries that are typical of modern geopolitical boundaries. But the history of the UAE goes back thousands of years. And it is a history of connectednesses in the plural. And one of the connectednesses, or one of the one of the spheres of influence, political spheres of influence that exerted pressure on UAE history was the Kingdom of Kish, which came after actually the pirates of Kish. Because I think it was only after Siraf was destroyed by the earthquake that the people in power, the merchants, decided to move to Kish and then establish this kingdom, which had held sway over the whole of the south coast of Arabia and then across India. So,
yeah, well, Kish, Siraf, all these places were so important. But there's one other thing I wanted to say, which is that, for me, Bomma became very, very important. And in a sense, Bomma's been a sort of recurring theme in my work long after that book, because
Bomma the slave.
Bomma is the slave, yeah. The slave who's, we just have, I tried to reconstruct the slave's identity from these three letters that we have, which is, B, M, H, essentially. But, the problem that you deal with whenever you approach South Asian history is, the namelessness of so many people who pass through this history, So, for example, Sea of Poppies, so much of it is about indentured workers. And again, you have this sort of profound silence, I think that's really what one struggles against when you're dealing with Indian history. On the one hand, of course, there are the great, kingly chronicles. But when you're trying to deal with ordinary lives. It's just this incredible silence. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, for almost 200 years, Indian sepoys really conquered an empire for the British, you know, from the 1760s until 1945. I mean, basically, the great weight of the British Empire was held, I mean, at least in a martial sense, was held up by Indian sepoys. Mm-hmm. In that entire period, from 1760 to 1918, we have one apocryphal memoir by a sepoy. One. You know, it's an extraordinary thing. I mean, many of these men were in fact literate. Many of them were Brahmins. Many of them came from literate families. But it's almost impossible to recreate, the voice of the sepoy. Even in the First World War, you know, there were 1.5 million Indians deployed in the First World War. About three times the number of Americans, you know. And there are only two memoirs actually written, by Indians about the First World War. Three. Mm-hmm. And actually the two, which I'm going to talk about on Sunday, are written not even by sepoys, but by medical auxiliaries. So, that's why when we do come across these sort of faint glimmers of, you know, individuality within the Indian past, especially of ordinary people, it just becomes so interesting and so important to try and kind of excavate them and, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Well, thank you both. I think, although I have a few more questions, I won't be selfish and let the audience.
I want to just, before we open it up for Q&A, make another point, which is that given the fact that this is a fatwa, an Islamic answer to a legal question about what to do with pages of the Quran that might be destroyed or worn out, and whether they can be burnt or buried, or first burnt and then bury the ashes. But the existence of Genizah as a custom of both Muslims and Jews, as well as the existence of the Genizah as a source for such things as the history of the Indian Ocean trade, or the history of merchants in the Mediterranean, or of Muslim-Jewish relations, to my mind, presents a almost unique opportunity for Arab scholars and Indian scholars and Jewish scholars to work together on the parallel custom of Genizah, as well as on the information in the Genizah that comes boiling to the surface once you dig deep. And I think that that's something that is worthwhile pondering. Mm-hmm.
Could I sort of crassly ask, that's a very sensitive issue and a rich proposition, but I was just wondering if you could quantify how much you think Goitein and all other scholars who've worked on the Genizah constitutes vis-a-vis the total that is left to do.
Oh, there's a lot left to do. And my graduate students know that. Now they're out with their PhDs teaching other graduate students in the field. There's the endless number of subjects and sub-subjects that can be investigated in the Genizah. The surface has only been scratched. And nowadays, students that I've been training are interested in really hardcore social history, history from below, as opposed to the history from above, the history of great intellectual figures. Boma is a history from below. Even the merchants themselves, compared to the ruling classes, are history from below. Mm-hmm. So this is something that really is available, and I have done a lot myself, and I think that Amitav's book is, when Amitav came to me first and I spoke to him, even though I was not able to give him access to the material and sent him off packing to England, I said to myself, that his book, whatever he would write, would do more for the Genizah than anything Goitein wrote. And I'm absolutely certain that that's the case.
Thank you. That's very generous.
Well, thank you both. So could I now open the floor up to questions?
You mentioned that you couldn't find materials on, you know, the everyday lives, simple people's lives. Why is there this dearth of that material, especially if we're not talking about uneducated people? You said, you know, they were Brahmins. You know, these are highly literate people. Why do you? Could you tell us why?
It confounds me because actually, you know, it's if you look at. Essentially, say, indentured workers from India and China were replacement for African slave labor, you know, after about 1820, 1830. Now, if you look at the African record, by the late 18th century, we have several slave narratives, you know, many. That's a very rich Africans were creating narratives about what was happening to them. But if you look at the millions of Indians and Chinese who left India and China from 1830s onwards, and there are literally millions of them, until the turn of the 20th century, there's not a single coolie narrative, not one. And amongst the Chinese too, there were many literate people. And again, you know, unlike India, China has a long tradition of creating records, you know. Why is there this kind of extraordinary silence in this realm of experience? I just don't know. Maybe we're looking in the wrong places. Maybe in sort of like clan association houses in Singapore and elsewhere, something will someday turn up. But for the time being, we have no narratives or memoirs of this experience.
I just wanted to ask something about the context of the Genizah, because Goitein speculated that during the sort of flurry of the Genizah in Egypt, that the truly great centers of Jewish wealth in the Indian Ocean were to be found in the Persian Gulf. So I wonder what your own take on that is, and how you think the Cairo Genizah fits relatively into the Jewish mercantile communities of the Indian Ocean.
So you're saying that this was a surprise to find that there was so
no,
much...
No, it's just that trying to figure out the relative position, how normative is the mercantile correspondence of the Genizah in comparison to what might have existed in the Gulf region or in South Arabia? How does the Genizah fit in? Because it's such a unique set of documents. You know, Goitein had to speculate as to its kind of broader context. And I wonder what your own speculation is.
Well, look, first of all, I can add to what I've been saying so far. The Genizah gives us a real cross-section of society. It's not just the merchants, and it's not just the people who wrote books, whose books are preserved in tattered manuscript form there, but all the way down to the poorest of the poor in the community. We have petitions from the poor, letters sent to would-be benefactors asking them for charity. We have myriad of documents that show how the Jewish community organized a charitable relief. I wrote a book on poverty and charity in the Genizah world on the basis of these documents. And I think in many cases it represents a cross-section of society. Now, several decades ago, archaeologists digging in the Red Sea port of Qusair al-Qadim, which was a port city during the Ptolemaic period, discovered a Muslim level and documents there of Muslim merchants. That's not the Persian Gulf. I don't know what documentation we have for this period from the Persian Gulf, frankly, I don't know. We know there was a trade between the Persian Gulf, between Iraq and India. But the trade route to India was diminished when the Fatimids took over Egypt in the 10th century, and they deliberately helped divert the India trade from the Persian Gulf to the route that went from Egypt up the Nile and across through Aden to India through the Indian Ocean, because they themselves were rivals of the Abbasid caliphs. So it's quite clear that this was quite normative for the period.
I'd like to add something to that, though. I think one has to also sort of see it, the Geniza and the Jewish diaspora there in the perspective of other trading diasporas, Most importantly, I think the Armenian diaspora. Because after all, one has to remember, say for example, the Ben Ezra Mosque is right next to the Church of the Muallakat, which is actually painted by an Armenian painter, Orhan Karabedian, after all, the Armenian diaspora was so important in Egypt from the time of from the Mamluks. So many of them came there. Then they brought their cousins, over. Some came as Mamluks, but the Mamluks brought their cousins over, and they remained Christians. And they lived cheek by jowl with. We have so many instances, of the Armenian diaspora, the Parsi diaspora, the Jewish diasporas, actually, sort of working, in this helical way with each other, creating these partnerships.
My question is in relation to Islamic law and Jewish law, like the similarities. There is the argument that Islam came to restore Jewish law principles. I mean, there's a lot of similarities between Islamic law and Jewish law as far as social principles and all that. I wanted to ask you, do you think that, because you mentioned that you didn't see a lot of uproar or, like there wasn't a lot of complaining, like there wasn't a lot of, amongst the people that were writing in these texts, there wasn't a lot of confusion, or they were not complaining about the way of life. They seemed to be living in harmony in Cairo or in these texts. So I wanted to know what your view about that is. Did you find that there was a lot of complaining, or what's the word? Like, did you feel a sense of harmony in the texts?
Maybe the word discomfort, would that work?
Sorry?
Discomfort. Look, If you read the theoretical texts, you think that the Jews, as an example, were entirely suppressed. When you read the Geniza documents, you find that they were aware of the fact that they were at the bottom of the hierarchy. Nonetheless, they carried on their lives. And they followed customs that the Muslim merchants followed. Where we have a handful of Muslim merchant letters from this period, the dynamic is just the same.
I'd like to have a question.
As far as law is concerned, Jewish law was very much influenced by Islamic law. And Jewish legal scholars had to adjust and adapt Jewish law to fit this new economy, which was not the economy of the pre-Islamic Talmudic period, which was an agrarian economy. And now you have long-distance trade, which Jews did not engage in before the Muslim period. So what do you do when you have an agrarian Talmud in a cosmopolitan long-distance trading society? Well, you have to adapt, because the merchants are going to follow their own customs regardless, and the rabbis knew that. And they, in other words, They followed the old adage, if you can't beat them, join them. And they adapted Jewish law to fit these. And that made it possible for Jews to conclude partnerships with Muslims. And if there was a dispute, it could go to the Islamic court. Now, the complaints that I mentioned before were of the hierarchy, the religious elite, always discourages that kind of act. But the very act itself shows us harmony. It wasn't harmony in the modern sense. It wasn't tolerance in the sense of John Locke's idea of tolerance. It's something else, but it still shows us a certain normalcy of life, which in spite of the fact that every Jew knew he was a Jew, and every Hindu knew he was a Hindu, and every Christian knew he was a Christian, and every Muslim knew he was a Muslim, and or a Shia Muslim or a Sunni Muslim, but nonetheless, there were certain realities of life that the Geniza reveals, that the society itself had a kind of cosmopolitan complexion to it within the boundaries of that kind of a society.
It was mentioned the abstract of this panel discussion that a new Geniza was discovered near the end of the 20th century.
19th century. Oh, are you talking about the new Geniza?
Yeah.
Right.
Can you say something about how it compares?
All right. Well, since my article was distributed, some of you probably read that section. In the late 1980s, the Egyptian Department of Antiquities, along with Ain Shams University, decided to dig in the Jewish cemetery ground, not where people were buried, but in the section that was not yet used for burying people. And they dug and they found documents buried in the ground. And they removed them, put them into bags, and they began to look at them, decide what was there. And then they published a catalog called Dalil Wathaik al-Geniza al-Gadida in Egyptian Arabic, which means a guide to the new Geniza, the new Egyptian Geniza. Now, the materials date primarily from the first half of the 20th century, and a little bit from the end of the 19th century. So there must be some relationship between that and the removal of the Cairo Geniza from the synagogue of Ben Ezra. We don't know why that was the case. The excavation itself was halted at a certain point for various reasons I won't go into, but I remain as convinced that if the excavation were continued, digging deeper into the earth would find documents that were from an even earlier period. Mm-hmm. So, these documents are very important for the history of Egyptian Jewry in the 20th century. And they are right now sitting in a room in Dar al-Kutub, which is the National Library of Egypt, Cairo. And to the best of my knowledge, nobody's working on them. That's regrettable.
Well, thank you for your questions, and please join me in thanking Mark Cohen and Amitav Ghosh.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.